Good morning. Welcome to our service this morning. If you're visiting with us, we hope you're feeling a warm welcome and that you'll come back and visit with us again. And of course, it's always good to see our usuals and just looking this morning to worship together. And that's what we're here to do with our music this morning and the words that are spoken and the prayers and Pastor Bill with his message that we come to worship. So have that in mind and in your hearts, and rise if you're able as we sing our opening number of Seek Ye First. I'm sorry, God Will Make a Way. Wrong page.
God will make a way where there seems to be no way. Works in ways we cannot see. He will make a way for me. He will be my guide. Hold me closely to his side. With love and strength for each new day, he will make a way. He will make a way.
Church, good to see you this morning. Isn't it good to know we have a God who will make a way for us? I want to welcome those who are watching online this morning. We'll welcome you again in just a moment, but as we are reminded, it's that time of year. We've got folks that are going home, and we invite you to keep up with us as we continue to broadcast on YouTube, and you keep up with us online as you are leaving us and going home for the season. We'll miss you terribly. We'll look forward to seeing you come back. Ladies, you have your Bible study Tuesday at 10 o'clock. Men's Life, we meet tomorrow at 2 p.m. in the community room. And guys, if you're missing your study sheets, Brian's got them. Brian, raise your hand. Brian's got them, so see him, and he'll make sure that he puts those into your hands for you. Want to remind you, we are still looking for somebody to help us in the PowerPoint department. That's booth work back there. So if you have any experience with PowerPoint, the Lord's laid that on your heart, you say, you know, I can handle that, please see Cheryl about that so we can get you signed up and helping us out with that. That's all the announcements I've got. So let's go to the Lord this morning in prayer. Father, how gracious you have been to us and how grateful we are for that grace to us. Lord, as we gather together in this place, we are reminded that we are standing on holy ground. As we gather as your people, we gather around your throne. We desire, Father, to praise you, to exalt you, and to lift you up. The songs that we sing are songs of Scripture and songs of praise and adoration. So I pray this morning, Father, that you inhabit our praises. Then as we gather around your word, to study your word this morning, I pray, Father, that our hearts and our minds will be cultivated afresh and anew. Lord, ready to receive the seed of your word deeply implanted in us so that we can grow by it. We don't want to just be hearers of your word. We want to be doers of your word as well. So, Father, take this time and use it for your honor, for your glory, and for our good. And we'll ask and pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Praise team, come lead us.
You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my only hope. Seeking you as a precious jewel, or to give up, I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Taking my sin, my cross, my shame, rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And hold me to your side. I will love and breath. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Scripture says, He has given us His great and precious promises. 2 Peter 1:4.
Y'all know this, standing on the promises. Sing with us.
Standing on the promises of Christ, my King, through eternal ages let His praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises, standing on the promises, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing on the promises, standing on the promises. I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises I now can see. Present cleansing in the blood for me. Standing in the liberty where Christ makes free. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises. Standing on the promises. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing on the promises. Standing on the promises. I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of Christ the Lord, will eternally be my last hope for. Overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword, standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises, standing on the promises, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing on the promises. Standing on the promises, I'm standing on the promises of God.
You may be seated. Thank you.
Amen. It's good to know we can stand on the promises of God's Word, isn't it? If you got your Bibles this morning, I invite you to open them with me. Join me in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 4. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 4. As we said before, I want to welcome those who are watching us online. If you're back home now and you're a snowbird, we invite you to keep up with us on YouTube. You can always go there to twrtimes.com, and you can download the link to the sermons there as well. And we invite those who are watching online to do that. Go to twrtimes.com, and you can download your free listening guides. Follow along with us as we study the Word of God together. Both the Bible and Jesus Christ are referred to as the Word of God. The Bible is God's written Word. Jesus is God's personal Word. Our relationship to one depends upon our relationship with the other. In other words, I cannot be rightly related to God if I'm not rightly related to the Bible. Or I cannot be rightly related to Jesus Christ if I'm not rightly related to the Word of God. So today I want to deal with the subject of the authority of God's Word in our lives. Perhaps there's no spiritual discipline that is more important for you and I to recognize than the authority of Scripture in our lives. Jesus, when he was being tempted by the devil, he said this when he was tempted to have bread. He said, man is to live by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Well, isn't it interesting that you and I call the Bible the Word of God? We call it God's Word. We call it God's book. But far too few of us actually give it that level of authority in our lives. The fact of the matter is that the level of authority that you give God's Word into your life really depends on you doing three things. You and I have personal responsibility here to give God the level of authority and God's Word the level of authority it deserves in our life for what it is and for how it is. And so what are those three things? Well, first of all, I want to tell you this morning, how you see God's Word determines what level of authority that you will give it in your life. We got to see God's Word for the authority that it is and for how it is in our life. But we've got an issue with authority. Let's just be honest. It's something we don't like. Nobody likes authority. In fact, we've been raised to resist authority. Benjamin Franklin, 240 years ago, said this. He said, it's the first responsibility of every citizen to question authority. And I can think of a lot of first responsibilities that citizens ought to have. That's probably not the top one. But we like that one, and we practice that one very, very well. In fact, we don't like government leaders, and so we vote them out. We don't like our kid's teacher, and so we go to the principal. We don't like our boss, and so we go to his boss or her boss. We don't like the rules, and so we argue with those people who try to enforce them. We don't like what the preacher says or what the preacher is teaching, and so we just go to another church. Listen, why? Because somehow, directly or indirectly, we are raised to resist authority. It's something we just don't like. The problem is this. Every one of us has an authority over us. There's not a person alive that doesn't answer to somebody. God has given parents authority over kids. They don't like it, but that's the way it is. God has given the husband authority over the wife. You may not like that, but that's what the Word of God says. God has given government authority over the citizens. You may not like it, but that's what the Word of God tells us is the case. Bosses have authority over workers. Christians have authority. Christ has authority over the church. And Scripture has been given its authority by God over our lives. It is our authority. Everyone existing today exists under the authority of someone or something. Now, ultimately, who is the authority? Well, God is the ultimate authority of all things, right? God is a ruler over all things. The earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. Everything is under God's authority, and God is the ultimate authority. But now, if you stop and consider the word authority, we get our word author from the word authority. In other words, when you look at this and you think about this, the authority of something comes from its author. The author is the authority of what the product is that they produce. And so it is with Scripture. You and I see that the author gives authority to whatever is produced in the Scripture. We have to ask the question then, who is the author of Scripture? Who is the author of the Bible? And the Bible clearly answers that question for us in a number of places. Paul tells us that all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. So what is Paul saying? Well, Paul says that all Scripture is given by God or by inspiration of God. He says that the Greek word there is God-breathed. He says that God has breathed His Word into existence. This means that the same word, by the way, that's used for breath is the identical same Greek word that's used for spirit. And what that means to us is the word that it means that all Scripture is in-breathed by the Spirit of God. Now, we've talked about this a little bit before, but that tells us that the Word of God has its ultimate authority where? In God Himself. God Himself is the ultimate authority of Scripture. That makes Scripture the authority of our lives. Now, He's used many different channels. The Bible tells us that He went about it using many different instruments. But behind them all is the authority of the Holy Spirit of God Himself. Peter tells us, above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation. For prophecy never had its origin in the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. Jesus himself testifies that Scripture is God's word. Jesus himself recognized that Scripture had divine authority, and we should too. Now, we see the way that Jesus used Scripture proved his reverence for it and his love for it. And the way that Jesus quoted Scripture to defeat the devil and answer those around him was simply amazing. He constantly referred to questions and phrases like this: have you not read? Or it is written. So if you read through the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5, 6, and 7, count the number of times or underline the number of times that Jesus uses those phrases: have you not read? Or it is written. Jesus spoke of Scripture as though they were the doctrine of God. So when you and I confront the Word of God, and we take the Bible into our hands, we are actually confronting God himself and his authority over our life. This is a book that God wrote to us as the authority of our life, to give us guidance and direction. The authority means that Scripture, every word, every stroke of the Bible possesses the authority of God, and therefore it has the right to rule our hearts and minds and bodies and everyone that inhabits the earth. Scripture's authority doesn't depend upon my ability to understand it. Scripture's authority doesn't depend upon my ability or willfulness to conform to it. Scripture's authority comes from God himself. He is the ultimate authority. Now, some time ago, the History Channel did a mini-series on the Bible. Based on Nielsen research, it was rated among the highest viewed miniseries on TV ever, showing that clearly Americans have an interest still in what the Bible is and what the Bible says. Now, that's a good thing, but it's a different thing when we say, okay, well, Americans have an interest in the Bible, but what do they actually believe about the Bible? What do they think about the Bible? What do Americans think about the Bible? Do they believe it's sacred? Do they believe it's authoritative? Do they believe it's merely nonsense? Do they follow its exhortations, or do they regard the Bible as antiquated literature? Does the Bible still matter today, or does it just matter in television ratings? Well, here's what the research found. Barna Research did this, and they commissioned by the American Bible Society, they found this. They found that nearly 9 out of 10, that's 88% of Americans, own a Bible. Now, despite that number being fairly high, it's way down from 1993, where they found that 92% of Americans owned a Bible. On the average, American Bible owners have 3.5 Bibles in their home. Listen to this. 1/4 of the Bible owners have more than 6 Bibles in their home. And what research showed is, in spite of the Bible seeming popularity, because it's still the number one selling book every year, there's been a great decrease in the number of people who have favorable or neutral view of the Bible. Even those who say that they believe that the Bible to be inspired, infallible, inerrant Word of God have to confess, I don't read it much. Isn't that a shame? Now, you see, how you see the Bible matters. What position you give the Bible in your life, it matters because of how you see it. And I'm talking about how you see it. I'm not talking about what we say about it. I'm talking about what we really believe about it. Now, because of this, if it's my intention, now hear me clearly, if it's your intention, if it's my intention to know God clearly and to know God intimately, I must know his word, because the two are related. I cannot have God apart from his word, and I cannot go to his word and not have God. They are together. And there's no spiritual discipline, I think, that's more important than you and I recognizing the authority of God's word in our life and accepting and applying Scripture to our life. Now, let me tell you, there's no substitute for it. There's no substitute for it, and there's simply no healthy Christian apart from a healthy diet of first the milk of the word and then getting into the meat of the word. If we don't see God's word that way, we're simply going to neglect his word. The fact of the matter is that we'll be like the man I heard about that was beaten up in the inner city. He was accosted by two men. They took his wallet, but it wasn't an easy task because he put up one fierce fight. I mean, he fought and fought, and his clothes were torn. His face was bleeding. he put up a terrible fight. And his friend asked him, he said, my goodness. He said, you must have had a lot of money in your wallet. You must have just gotten your paycheck, had your whole paycheck in your wallet. The man said, no, the money wasn't the issue. He said, the fact of the matter is, I only had $4.25. His friend said, you had $4.25 and you put up a fight like that? You risked your life for $4.25? Are you crazy? What were you thinking? The man said, well, I was embarrassed. I didn't want them to know how little money I had. The fact of the matter is, do you know the devil doesn't want you to know how spiritually rich you are? The devil doesn't want you to know the fact is that you are spiritually blessed, empowered, and how equipped you can be. He doesn't want you to know that you are wealthy in Christ, that you've been made to sit in heavenly places with the Lord Jesus Christ, that you are more than a conqueror through Jesus Christ, that you can accomplish all things through Christ. He doesn't want you to know the fact that Jesus died on the cross for your sins, that he died there and he rose again the third day, and he conquered death and the devil, and he gave to us the ability to have eternal life in heaven, but also eternal life beginning right now, where we can enjoy life and have it more abundantly. He doesn't want you to know that. And so what he wants to do is he wants to get you to have a wrong attitude about the Bible. He wants you to not see the Bible for what it is. So the devil's going to do all he can to make sure that you see the Bible as something that's unimportant, that's unnecessary, question its authority so that you'll neglect it, ignore it, and ultimately be unfamiliar with it. He said, why would the devil put that kind of energy into distracting me from God's Word? Well, the fact of the matter is, he'll do it so that he can deceive you and devour you with ease. Because if you don't know the Word of God, you don't have any protection against the enemy of God and against the enemy of you. So I want to encourage you this morning, don't let him do that. Don't let the devil convince you that the Bible is unimportant, that it's unnecessary. Don't let the Bible convince you that it's okay to put your Bible down in the same place this Sunday, that you'll find it next Sunday. Don't let him convince you that you ought not to be in the Word or read the Word or be taking in the Word and giving it the place of authority that it ought to have in your life, the divine authority over your heart, your mind, and your life. Someone has commented and said, the worst dust storm in history would happen if every Christian who neglects their Bible picked it up simultaneously and dusted it off. You know what I say to that? Let the dust fly. Because it's time that you and I pick up the Word of God, get back into the Word of God. Now, I want you to see something else. Not only is how we see the Bible matter, not only is that very important, that we see it as the authority of our life and that we see it correctly, but also the next thing that would give the Bible the authority in our life is how we receive the Word. You and I have to pay attention to how we take the Word of God into our life. The fact of the matter is that Christ answered all the temptations of Satan. It is written. He set an example for you and I in Scripture by saying that. He appealed to the devil about what was written in Scripture. This is the same method that you and I have to take when you and I are wrestling with temptation or wrestling with sin. We have to consult the Word of God and say, what is written there? We can't do that unless we take in the Word of God. So the question becomes, how do I do that? Well, it requires me to discipline myself to do four things. First one is hearing the Word of God. Sometimes we just receive the Word of God just by listening to it, just by hearing the Word. If we don't discipline ourselves to hear the Word of God regularly, we may only hear it occasionally, we may hear it accidentally, we may hear it mistakenly, or we may not hear it at all. If I don't discipline myself to regularly be hearing the Word of God. Jesus said, blessed are those who hear the Word of God and obey it. Now, of course, hearing it is not the point. Hearing it for obeying it is the point. That's what we want to do. We want to hear it and listen to God's Word so that we can obey it. And God can guide us and equip us and build us up in our faith and direct our path day by day, growing us in our faith. That's why we want to hear the Word of God. Isn't that what Paul said? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Sure. So we want to be hearing the Word of God, all right? Second thing we want to do to receive the Word of God, we want to read the Word of God. When Jesus said we are to live by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God, certainly he at least meant we ought to read it. I mean, that's what he was saying here. He was suggesting that because he oftentimes questioned the people that were giving him a hard time, haven't you read? Haven't you heard? Revelation 1:3 tells, blessed is the one who reads the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. Paul told us this, and we ought to read the Word of God because it is profitable. It is God-breathed. It is profitable for teaching, rebuking, correcting, training in righteousness. Somebody said, well, how often should I read the Bible? I like what what one teacher said. Author Jerry Briggs wrote this. He says, that reading gives us... he says, how often should we read it? British preacher John Blanchard, in his book, How to Enjoy the Bible, he wrote this. He said, well, let me ask you a question. How often do you face problems, temptations, and troubles? Every day. He said, how often do you need instruction, guidance, and greater encouragement? Every day. So the answer to those two questions is the same answer as how often I should read the Bible. Every day. Because I face these things and I need help every day. We have to receive the Word of God by hearing it, reading it, thirdly, by studying it. Author Jerry Briggs wrote this. He said, reading gives us breath, studying gives us depth. The Bible is the book of God. It is owned by more people in America than any other single book. But what do Bible owners really believe about the Bible? Listen to this. What do they know about the Bible? 82%, these are amazing statistics. 82% say the idea that God helps those who help themselves is taken directly from Scripture. It is not. Nowhere in the Bible is that statement made. 66% say there is absolutely no truth. 63% cannot name the four Gospels. 58% cannot name half or more of the Ten Commandments. 58% do not know Jesus preached the Sermon on the Mount. 52% don't know the book of Jonah is in the Bible. 48% don't know the book of Thomas is not in the Bible. 39% don't know that Jesus was born in Bethlehem. 30% don't know there were 12 apostles. I'm reminded of the Sunday school teacher who was teaching a class of boys, and he asked this question. He said, who was it in the Old Testament that went into the den of lions and came out unharmed? One boy blurted out, Tarzan! Listen, the fact of the matter is, far too many, including Christians, far too many Christians and others have Bibles in their homes, but not in their hearts. And that's the real tragedy. That's why we study the Word of God, is to get it into our hearts. R.C. Sproul put it plainly and clearly, painfully clearly, in fact, when he wrote this. He said, here then is the problem of our negligence. We fail in our daily study of God's Word, not so much because it's difficult to understand, not so much because it's dull or boring, but because it's work. Our problem is not lack of intelligence or lack of passion. Our problem is we're lazy. And that's true. Studying the Word of God is work. Fourthly, we need to receive the Word of God by applying the Word of God to our life. Jesus, in his prayer for us to the Father in John 17, he prayed this prayer. He said, Father, sanctify us by the truth. And then he said, your word is truth. To sanctify means to make one holy. And it happens when we take God's principles, God's promises, God's commands, his precepts, and we apply them to our lives. We apply them to our conduct. We apply them to our conversations. We apply them to our decision-making. We apply them to our relationships, and so on and so forth. Taking God's word, reading it, studying it, understanding it, and knowing what to do with it, how to use it in our lives. You can only do that when you receive the Word of God and you interpret it properly, because proper interpretation leads to proper application. But without correct interpretation, there cannot be proper application. So you and I need to read the Word, hear the Word, read the Word, study the Word, so that we know what the Word says and we know how to use it. It's a brand new illustration for me, but Brother Steve in the booth back there is a very handy, very crafty man. And he showed me a new tool that he's got, that he can program this thing and set it to go, and it makes great designs on woodwork. But as he explained, he said, you got to have a skill level. You got to know how to program it. You got to know how to use it. Well, the same thing is true with us. There's a skill level to the Word of God. You got to hear it. You got to read it. You got to study it so that you know the skill level of how to use it in your life for it to be effective. Now, the devil is trying to get Jesus to violate God's word in this passage. He's trying to get him to serve his own interests. And he did four times he came to Jesus and tried to do this. And each time, Jesus resisted him. And how did he do it? We're amazed. But every time that he tried it, Jesus resisted him using Scripture. Psalms tells us that God's word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. We sang that this morning. But you got to know how to turn the light on for the light to be effective. You got to know, you know, somebody hands you a, have you ever had one of those tricky flashlights? Somebody hands you a flashlight and says, hey, here's a flashlight. And you say, how do you turn this thing on? Well, it's, you got to know how to turn the light on for the word to be a light unto your path. And we do that by hearing it, reading it, studying it, so we can properly use it in our lives. Let me just add one more thing to this note, if I can. I believe that that we ought to study the book to get guidance from God, hear the revelation of His heart to us. I believe that we ought to do that for our own sake, but I also believe we ought to be doing it for others' sake. I think that you ought to be, and I ought to be, sharing what we learn from God's Word. I think that every individual, the Bible calls us teachers. The Bible calls you a teacher. I know that some of you resist that and say, well, I'm no teacher. The Bible says, yes, you are. And you are to be teaching others. You're to be sharing what you know from the Word of God with others and sharing it with each other. And so I want to encourage you to find somebody to teach the Word of God. You say, well, now I don't know enough about the Bible to do that. Well, let me tell you something. All you got to do to be a teacher is know more than somebody else does. And then you can share with them. Like the old boy that I read about, was asking his neighbor, he said, Steve, how do you teach your dog so many tricks? I can't teach my dog anything. Steve came back and said, well, first of all, you got to be smarter than the dog. Well, as we study God's word, we learn from it, and we find so much more in there. And let me tell you what happens when you begin to study God's word, and it begins to come alive to you, begins to speak to you. It ignites a fire of excitement in you, and then you do look for other people to share. Let me share with you what I read this morning. Let me share with you what I studied today. Let me share with you what God spoke into my life today through His Word. So I would encourage you to be teachers of others. The level of authority that we give God's Word, how we see it, right? How we receive it. And then finally, how we treat it. How do you treat the Word of God? Well, I think first and foremost, it's obvious. We should believe it. The Bible tells us our response to God's word should be like Peter's. Simon Peter answered him and said, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We should be looking to receive the word of God, every word of it, because it's more than sufficient. We should be staking our all upon it. I believe it. I believe every word of it. I believe every word of it because God said it. I believe every word of it because it's God's authority over my life. Abraham told the rich man in torment, he said, if they don't listen to Moses and the prophets, he's talking about Scripture. If they don't listen to Moses and the prophets, they won't be convinced even if someone rises from the dead. We meet people, you meet people all the time who are looking for signs, who are looking for miracles. You know, I just need a sign. I need a miracle. I need God to show me something. Well, the Bible is a revelation of God. If you won't believe the revelation of God, you're not going to believe a sign or a miracle either. So the fact of the matter is that we ought to believe the Bible. By the way, God's not the only one who does miracles. Sometimes the devil uses those things as deceptive tools. You and I need to understand that the Word of God is faithful and true. Experience may or may not be true, but the Word of God is true. And that's what we trust and what we believe in. We should also love it. I love what the psalmist said in Psalm 119. He said, oh, how I love your law. Psalmist declared his love and his dedication to and his devotion to the law because it gave him understanding. It gave him wisdom to deal with his enemies and his teachers and his elders. By God's word, he said, it kept me pure. Do you know the Bible wasn't written for information? It was written for your transformation. In other words, you and I read the Word of God so the Word of God will change us. Not just to gain information. You know, well, I want to go fact-finding. I want to go read stories. I want to go find stuff in the Bible that I can go out and talk about all kinds of things. Well, here's how it happens when you and I read the Word of God and it begins to change us. First of all, when the child of God reads the Word of God, he sees the Son of God and is transformed by the Spirit of God into the image of God for the glory of God. That's why we read and study the Word of God. is to transform us. This is what the psalmist said and why we should love it. One of my favorite Bible teachers is a fellow by the name of Dr. Warren Wiersbe. Once made this statement that we should all remember. He said, the purpose of the Bible study is not to brag, argue, or to debate about what we know, or to split Sunday school classes or churches. The purpose of Bible study is to live righteous, godly lives. We ought to love the Word of God as God's book because it has the power to do that for us. But let me tell you, secondly, we should trust it. We should love it, but we should trust it. When we see Jesus being tempted by the devil all these times, if all the devil was trying to do was get Jesus to use or abuse his supernatural powers, Jesus' response would have been way off point. So that wasn't what was going on there. The temptation was to doubt or to bypass God's word and God's plan. So we see that Jesus' point is directly, or Jesus' answer is directly on point. Jesus' answer was, and I'm paraphrasing now, so don't say, my Bible doesn't say that. I'm just paraphrasing. Jesus was basically saying to the devil, you know what? It really doesn't matter whether I have physical food or I eat or not, since God will preserve my life as long as he wants to, so I can do what he wants me to do, and I will trust him to do that. How did Jesus know to answer that? How did he know to say that, no, man doesn't live by bread alone. He lives by every word that proceeds, that comes out of the mouth of God. How did he know to say that? Because he knew the Word of God. And he used the Word of God in a right manner to answer the attack of the devil who was trying to get him to sidestep the Word of God. It wasn't God's Word that was being tested. It was Jesus who was being tested to continue to trust and obey the Word. Let me explain something to you this morning. We look and we read about the temptation of Jesus. Can I assure you of something? You're going to face those same temptations. I'm going to face those same temptations. We're going to have those same battles. And we're going to have the same choices that Jesus had. When I'm confronted by the devil with temptation or trials or tribulations in my life, I'm going to have the same choices. Do I jump out on my own? Do I sidestep the authority of God's Word? Or do I return to God's Word and say, what is written? What has been said by God? And I'm going to have those same choices, and I can have the same victory if I will trust in the Word of God like Jesus did. Finally, we should obey it. He said, what does obedience to God's word look like? Are you ready? This might even be worth writing down. You ready? Here's what obedience looks like. Just do it. Oh, I know you've heard that before. Yeah, just do what it says. Just do what it says. That's what obedience looks like. When I do what the Word of God says, I'll be obedient to the Word of God. By the way, it's better to obey the Word of God than it is for you and I to satisfy our human desires. Here's what happens. Persistent disobedience to God's Word, whether you know it or not, is often going to result in divine discipline. Some cases it can be very serious. I've listed several scriptures there on your listening guide for you to visit, to go back and look at. God disciplines those that He loves, and sometimes that discipline can be deep. And can be serious. Somebody says, well, how do I know that I'm being disobedient to the Word of God? Listen, it's one thing to be unfamiliar with the Word of God if you don't have a copy. It's altogether a different thing to be disobedient to the Word of God when you've got a whole bookshelf full. An unread Bible is about as useless as an uncranked car, or an unloaded gun, or a worthless undiscovered treasury. I heard about a man who owned a vineyard. His sons were pretty sure that he was extremely wealthy, but they couldn't be positive because he was really cagey about it. They were hoping that when he died, they would inherit his wealth. But as he was on his deathbed, he told his sons, the secret to my wealth will be found in the vineyards. After he died, the boys went out to the vineyards and they began digging. Well, they dug up and they pulled up every weed. They cleared out all the grass. They were careful not to harm the vines, but they dug everywhere looking for that wealth. That fall, that vineyard produced the finest crop of grapes in the history of the family. And the boys realized the father had duped them into stop sitting around waiting for somebody to hand you something and go out there and work for it. The secret to his wealth was in the vines. And the fact of the matter is that if they properly cared for them, they'd make them very, very rich. Now the truth is, you and I have a vineyard also. It's called the Word of God. And it can prove to make one wealthy and wise, not necessarily materialistically, but certainly for life. But we got to get in there and dig. We got to get in there and cultivate that vineyard. We've got to get out of it what God has put into it. And to do that, we've got to go in there and tend to the vineyard and dig up the truth and take it in. If you want what the Word of God can do for you, you got to treat it properly. You got to learn to love it and to trust it, to obey it, study it. We should believe it. We should trust it, love it. Listen, both the Bible and Jesus Christ are called the Word of God. The Bible is God's written word. Jesus is God's personal word. And our relationship to one is determined by our relationship with the other. You cannot be rightly related to Jesus and wrongly related to the Bible. It doesn't work that way. The Bible is God's authoritative word. It is God's message to man. We need to see it that way. We need to receive it that way. We need to treat it that way. And when we do, what will happen? Well, it'll change you from the inside out. It'll change you from the outside in. It'll help you be all that God has designed you to be. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the authority, the power of your word. I pray, Father, that you will whet our appetite, every one of us, to love it, trust it, receive it, and obey it. It's no mere book. It's a living, breathing document, the light into our path. When we read the Word of God, we find the truth that you loved us so much, you sent Jesus to die for sinners because they had a debt they couldn't pay. And to be reunited with you in right fellowship, they have to put their faith and trust in a risen, living Savior by the name of Jesus Christ. That's in your word. That's the light that gets turned on that gives us new life, eternal life. I want to ask you, if you're in this place today or you're watching us online, if you've never trusted in your Redeemer, Jesus, to be your Lord and Savior, the Bible tells us that we first must believe upon Him with our heart, then we must call upon Him with our mouth, trusting in Him to be our Savior, and then following Him as our Lord. And we learn to follow Him again through His written word to us. I encourage you today, if you've never done that, would you simply right now say, "Dear Jesus, I believe. I believe you're the Son of God. I believe you came from heaven to earth. I believe you died on that cross in my place to pay my sin debt. I put my faith and trust in you today to be the Savior and Redeemer of my sins. And then I commit to read your word, study your word, to follow you in accordance with your word." Christian, I want to encourage you today, if it has not been your habit, to daily read the word, study the word, hear the word, receiving the word. Habits are formed when we start. So I would encourage you, start a new habit today. Pick up the word of God. Begin to read it, study it, and apply it to your life. And by the help of the Holy Spirit, you will be able to do that. He is the authority. He is also the author and your guide. Father, we give you thanksgiving again for your word today. Encourage us to take on the task, the joyful task of reading your word to us, the light unto our path. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, church, we're getting ready this week to go out into a mission field. We talk about it every week. It's a very real thing. The people out there are looking for answers everywhere. You just talk to them, you'll figure it out. They've got questions. They're curious. Don't forget to be Jesus to them. Don't forget to share Jesus with them. And don't forget to invite them to know the Jesus you know that has given you the answers you have about what is eternal life and what is abundant life that you have in Christ. God bless you. Have a wonderful week. I will be gone next Sunday. Randy will be here. Be praying for Randy. And be here to encourage him as he's bringing the message that God has laid on his heart for you. And I'll see you in 2 weeks. God bless.
Standing on the promises of Christ the King, to eternal ages let his praises sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises, standing on the promises, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing on the promises. Standing on the promises, I'm standing on the promises of God.
And go knowing that the promises that he's told us are true and will come to life if you live the life that Jesus lived. So go and spread the peace that we have with others, and go in that peace in Jesus' name. Amen.